Hi and welcome to my presentation about the Arado 234, which is a model kit from Revell. I'm going to do this presentation in Pecha-Kucha style, which means that you have 20 seconds per slide and the presentation is 20 slides long. In this presentation, I will basically talk about the process of making the thing on the top from the things on the bottom. This process is called model building, and there is a definition of it in which I highlighted the core words red on the left hand side. As the definition says, there's always a real object. And this real object is in this case the Arado 234, that was one of the first jet aircraft ever flown. It saw service between 1944 and 1945 on the German side, mainly as reconnaissance aircraft and fast bomber. I'm going to show you how to build the model in 8 steps. We start with some work on details. The next steps afterwards are all about the electronics and how to light it up. In step 5, it all needs to be assembled. And the final 3 steps deal with varnishing. So let's start with the first step, detail assembly. All the parts shown on the top belong to the cockpit and need to be assembled before anything else. The bottom picture shows the assembly of the tailplane, the wheels, and additional fuel tanks using glue. Once the small parts are assembled, they need to be painted. This can be done using both brush and airbrush. On the top, you can see the assembled and painted cockpit and a pen and a brush for size comparison. On the bottom, some more via airbrush painted parts. The next challenge afterwards is about designing electric circuits. First, a theoretical layout with light-emitting diodes and resistors must be developed. And then we have to deal with very small parts, as small as the little yellow LEDs shown on the top next to the wire and the needle. However, tests show that these parts can shine quite bright nevertheless. Here you can see the electronics in the wings. They consist of a flashing white LED and a red or green position light in each wingtip. However, the wings had so little space at the tips that the use of 0.5 mm thick optic fibers that are connected to the LEDs is necessary there. In the engines, on the other hand, there is enough space to use bigger red LEDs. They are once more connected to fiber optics that shine on their sides to achieve a glowing effect, which we will see later. The picture on the right shows the full engine assembly, including resistors for the LEDs. In the cockpit, an interesting look is created with the use of several LEDs in various colors. Those far too long optic wires you can see sticking out of the boards in the picture on the top are cut down in the second picture, so it looks like indicator lights and displays. In the beginning of the assembly process, which is step 5, it is necessary to glue the engines to the wings and solder all the wires, so that we have only 2 output wires. On the upper picture, you can see the engine light effect for the first time. Next, the cockpit is glued into the main fuselage assembly and all wires are connected. Furthermore, also some ballast mass, which you can see at the top, needs to be put in the fuselage as well, so that the plane does not flip to its back when standing on its wheels later on, which sometimes happens when you forget the mass. After the assembly and right before varnishing, it is then necessary to apply masking tape for the further assembled plane. This is mainly due to the reason that the airbrush color will cover everything that is not protected. We don't want that. So we have to tape everything that shouldn't have color on it. The first step of the actual airbrushing is called pre-shading. You apply black lines to all the ledges you want to highlight to improve optic depth. You can see the effect on the picture on the right hand side after a grey coating has been applied to the underside. There are slight and dark grey areas on the plane. Then it's time for the camouflage scheme on top of the aircraft. First, green color is applied using a relatively fine airbrush needle, then also a coat of olive color. In case for people who don't know, airbrushing means applying color not using a regular brush, but using a stream of air to distribute the color comparable to a spraying can. After some more taping work, we can paint the engines and the wheel boxes. The engines get a metallic silver coat applied via airbrush, whereas the wheel boxes are painted using a regular brush. This leads us then to the final step 8. The step 8 is also divided into two sub-steps. The first one is applying markings. This is basically the same process as the rest of the airbrushing. First, cover everything that you don't want to have color on, and then spray over it. The picture on the bottom shows the result. And finally, it's time for weathering, the process of making it look more realistic with dirt and rust. The black color and the lines on the left-hand side is done by brushing the model with thin color and then clearing the color away on the surfaces so it only stays in the grooves and represents dirt. Furthermore, with special pens, you can, for example, apply rust next to the flap. This has been the whole process. Now, to conclude my talk, I'm showing you some pictures of the result of the process. Namely, a view into the cockpit, the engine intakes, and the aircraft from the side. On the next slide, there will be a video of the plane with all the light effects. Now, at the front, you can see the landing lights. And then the camera turns to the sides, where the flashing light and the position light appears. Finally, as you come to the very back, you can see the engine light effect on all four engines. Which then brings my talk to a conclusion. Thank you all for listening, and yeah, I'm looking forward for your questions in the comments. Thanks!